Thank you. The final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 8629 in the name of Stuart McMillan on Scotland's liver cancer crisis. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons. And I call on Stuart McMillan to open the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Mr McMillan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. First of all, I'd just like to remind the Chamber that I'm the Vice-Chair of Moving On Invercloud, a local addiction service. I'm just erring on the side of caution by reminding the Chamber of that. Presiding Officer, I'm pleased to have secured this important debate, and in advance I'd like to thank my colleagues from across the Chamber for their contributions tonight, but also for those who have signed the motion to allow this debate to take place. The title of tonight's debate is Scotland's Liver Cancer Crisis. Might appear drastic to some, and up until recently I didn't realise that liver disease and liver cancer was such an acute problem in Scotland. Yet figures from the British Liver Trust show deaths due to chronic liver disease in Scotland have increased by 85% in the last three decades, and surged by almost a fifth, 19.3%, during the pandemic between 2019 and 2021. Now, sadly, Scotland has consistently had the highest mortality rate for liver disease in the UK, and one of the highest in Europe. Now, these two facts paint a very harrowing picture. And when you consider that 90% of liver disease is preventable, tackling this situation becomes even more urgent. Presiding Officer, the main risk factors for liver disease and alcohol misuse, obesity and viral hepatitis. However, the liver has a remarkable ability to actually regenerate and repair itself. If diagnosed earlier, liver damage can be reversed, and risks can be drastically reduced through diet, exercise and drinking in moderation. Despite this, a quarter of liver disease patients die on readmission to hospital, and deaths after discharge have not improved in two decades. Clearly then, we cannot continue with the status quo. We must consider new ways of preventing and treating liver disease. Policies like the minimum unit pricing are, however, very welcome, and from talks I've had with the British Liver Trust and others, clinicians in England and Wales want to see this policy replicated UK-wide due to its positive impact in Scotland. But minimum unit pricing alone is not driving down preventable liver disease. As well as looking at other policies to address alcohol-related harm, we must tackle the availability of junk food and encourage people to make healthier choices. Now, that is difficult in the cost of living crisis. Now, that is all the harder when you consider the health inequalities which make obesity and alcohol misuse more likely in deprived communities, such as part of my own Greenock and Inverclyde constituency. During the recent meeting with the British Liver Trust, I was told that Inverclyde reported the highest rate of alcohol-specific deaths in 2017 to 2021, the majority of which were caused by alcohol-related liver disease. Now, marginalised and disadvantaged groups are also most at risk of viral hepatitis, including people who inject drugs, that's with hepatitis C, and migrant communities from endemic countries, that's hepatitis B. Now, alarmingly, one in two people with hepatitis C live in the 20% most deprived areas of Scotland. And that's why I was so determined to secure a members' debate on this issue, as it's something which evidently is having a major impact on the lives of some people in my constituency. Yet when people think about cancer, there are certain types that typically spring to mind first, most likely because of prominent charities or campaigns focused on specific types of cancers. But importantly, that greater attention is given to liver cancer, as it has seen the largest increase in mortality rates of all cancer types over the last decade. Now, Presiding Officer, you may be aware that I've also been raising awareness of bladder cancer, hosting Fight Bladder Cancer's first Scottish parliamentary event in February of this year, as it's not one that people often think of when they hear the word cancer. Reducing the rate of liver disease among Scotland's population is not going to happen solely through policies like minimum unit pricing or taxing unhealthy foods. And we won't prevent more deaths by just asking people to change their unhealthy habits. Now, these policies have a role to play, an important role to play, but we need to improve patient pathways for the early detection and management of liver disease. But 3/4 of people are diagnosed with cirrhosis when it's too late for effective treatment or intervention. So we must improve detection rates and work to get treatment in place as soon as possible. And that's why I support the British Liver Trust's call for new national guidance on liver disease to improve early diagnosis, including through the national rollout of the intelligent liver functions tests and fibro scans in primary and community care. Now, some colleagues will have had the opportunity to undergo a fibro scan yesterday if they visited the British Liver Trust's Love Your Liver Roadshow. Now, these free scans are quick, easy and painless, and the Love Your Liver Roadshow unit has private rooms for people to have the scan. As the fibro scan checks for signs that your liver has been damaged, I'm hoping to bring the Love Your Liver Roadshow to Inverclyde so people in my constituency can actually access this technology, which could lead to them learning if they might have liver damage and and being given a letter to take to their GP for further investigations. I also agree with the charity's call to expand treatment and support for people with alcohol depending, specifically integrated non-invasive tests for liver fibrosis and alcohol services to target high-risk dependent drinks. Alcohol recovery services will understandably, at least in the first instance, focus on helping people progress on the recovery journey and to live a life free of addiction. But it's crucial that these organisations are supported to work in partnership with health services to ensure that people receive the healthcare that they will need as a result of their alcohol dependency. Presiding Officer, in closing, hope that today's debate will give us all a greater impetus to work towards improving early detection and survival rates for the less survivable cancers, including liver cancer, and hope that this will be at the heart of the Scottish Government policy making going forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms McMillan. We now move to the open part of the debate. I call Claire Hockey to be followed by Annie Wells. Around 4 minutes, please, Ms Hockey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I congratulate my colleague Stuart McMillan on securing this important debate. 90% of liver disease is preventable, yet sadly it's one of the leading causes of premature death in Scotland. In addition, liver cancer has seen the largest increase in mortality rates of all cancer types over the last decade, now being the fastest rising cause of cancer death in the UK. It is vitally important that we focus on the prevention of liver disease and liver cancer and step up efforts to detect them earlier. And for this reason, I welcome the news that NHS Lanarkshire has partnered with the British Liver Trust to launch a series of Love Your Liver roadshows across Lanarkshire this summer. The Love Your Liver mobile unit will stop at 10 locations in Lanarkshire over the next 3 months to find people who have been exposed to hepatitis C virus, a silent disease that can lead to severe liver complications if left undetected. Visitors to the unit will have the opportunity to gain information about hepatitis C, receive a non-invasive liver scan and swab test if they are identified as being at high risk of hepatitis C and liver disease. And the roadshow will be in my Rutherglen constituency at Morrison's Cambus Lang on Wednesday the 26th of July. And I would greatly encourage constituents to attend. Certainly.
Fulton McGregor.
Yeah, I thank the member for taking the intervention. It's just to say on that does she also acknowledge that the Liver Roadshow will be in Coatbridge this Friday, and I would also encourage my constituents to attend to that.
Claire Hockey.
Thank you. Presiding Officer, I would like to focus the remainder of my speech specifically on alcohol misuse and its contributory impact on liver disease. Alcohol harm is on the rise, with a 22% increase in alcohol-specific deaths in the last 2 years. Nearly 1 in 15 of all deaths in Scotland are caused by alcohol, mainly due to cancer, stroke and heart disease. An estimated 16% of ambulance call-outs in Scotland are alcohol-related, and one person is admitted to hospital due to alcohol every 15 minutes. In 2021, NHS Lanarkshire, the health board that covers my Rutherglen constituency, reported the second highest mortality rate due to chronic liver disease across all health boards in Scotland. And earlier this month, I had the opportunity to meet with Alcohol Focus Scotland and clinicians who specialise in the harm of alcohol misuse. One of the main issues they raised with me was how normalised alcohol drinking is in the UK and how readily available alcohol is to buy. According to Scottish Liquor Licence statistics for 2021-22, there are 710 places to buy alcohol in South Lanarkshire, around 460 of which in pubs and restaurants, and the remainder in shops. And during my discussion with Alcohol Focus Scotland and the clinicians, we spoke of the beneficial effects of the minimum unit pricing, without which the impact on reducing alcohol-related harm or liver disease would likely be even greater. The recent Public Health Scotland and University of Glasgow study indicates a 13.4% reduction in deaths and a 4.1% reduction in hospital admissions, wholly attributable to alcohol consumption in the first 2.5 years after minimum unit pricing was introduced. And I know the Scottish Government is currently reviewing the 50 pence minimum unit pricing rate, with calls from Alcohol Focus Scotland for an increase to the level. As convener of the Parliament's Health, Social Care and Sport Committee, I look forward to seeing more details of the Government's plans regarding this in due course. Presiding Officer, alcohol-related harm is one of the most pressing public health challenges that we face in Scotland. There were 2,340 alcohol-related hospital admissions in South Lanarkshire in 2021-22. 77 people died in South Lanarkshire from conditions solely caused by alcohol over the same period. And every year, alcohol costs South Lanarkshire an estimated £301 per person. But of course, in truth, the cost is not just financial. The impact of a loved one being hospitalised or dying due to alcohol can be devastating for the person themselves, their friends, their family and on their wider community. And this Scottish Government has taken action to prevent and reduce this, including the minimum unit alcohol policy, the reduction of the drink driving limit and the multi-buy discount ban. But we shouldn't be complacent. We should recommit to doing all we can to tackle the challenges of liver disease and liver cancer in order to save lives.
Thank you, Ms Huggy. I now call Annie Wells to be followed by Carol Malkin. Around 4 minutes, please, Ms Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's my privilege to take part in today's debate on liver cancer, and I would like to start off by thanking Stuart McMillan for bringing this important topic to the Chamber. I'd also like to join Stuart McMillan in commending the promotion of intelligent liver function tests and non-invasive liver scans by charities in primary and community care. These methods help to quicken early detection of liver cancer and liver disease, which lessens the existing pressure in our NHS and, most importantly, saves lives. The scale of this public health crisis is all too common within our nation. This is a grim reality concerning the pervasiveness of this problem when compared to the rest of the UK and other European countries. And this is precisely why I come to this debate and join my colleagues from across the Chamber to address such a destructive issue that plagues many Scots. And for context, the British Liver Trust alludes to the fact that anyone can develop liver disease. However, when non-genetic risk factors are accounted for, which include alcohol, excessive body weight, and viral hepatitis, compose 9 out of 10 cases of liver disease. These factors affect a plethora of groups. Disadvantaged individuals are most at risk of developing viral hepatitis, and this includes residents of areas that lack sufficient patient care pathways. Liver disease is not the only of the leading causes of premature death, but it is also one of the principal risk factors for developing liver cancer. Mortality rates from liver disease itself too are very alarming, and as we've heard, men are 2 times more likely to die from liver disease, and women have experienced a 16% increase in deaths from 2012 to 2020. Public Health Scotland states that improved lifestyle factors, including a healthy diet, lower alcohol consumption and reducing obesity, have, and they quote, considerable potential to prevent cancers. Additionally, Public Health Scotland indicated that from 1995 to 2020, of the most common cancers, liver cancer had the biggest increase in mortality rates in the last decade, which sat at 38%. Survival from liver cancer is poor in most cases. The main risk factor for liver cancers are obesity, alcohol, and infection with hepatitis B and C viruses. The average one-year survival rate for liver cancer in Scotland stood at 40%. This makes liver cancer have a lower survival rate than any other forms of cancer. This has tragic consequences, as relative to the UK, the greatest rise in liver cancer was among Scottish men when compared to people in other parts of the country. Also, while liver cancer constituted only 2% of cancers across our nation in 2017, rates have seen a greater increase than all other parts of the UK. University of Edinburgh Professor Linda Bald has described the state of liver cancer deaths and the number of diagnoses in Scotland as shocking. She continued by saying that the rise in cancer rates of the past few decades should concern all of us. Groups such as charities that focus on liver disease and liver cancer provide invaluable support and information for Scots to lower their chances of developing liver cancer through lifestyle changes. And I also would welcome the additional input of these charities in scrutinising reports and legislation such as the Scottish Government's National Cancer Plan. But from contributions today, I know that MSPs from across the chamber will work constructively to take this debate forward as we move forward. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Wells. And I now call Carol Mochan. Around 4 minutes, please, Ms Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I give my thanks also to Stuart McMillan for securing this timely and really important debate. To say that we have a liver cancer crisis in Scotland is both patently true and deeply concerning for all of us who have for decades seen various reforms to limit alcohol misuse and obesity not go far enough. Progress has been made, but the statistics speak plainly to the damage that has been done, and lives continue to be lost with all the knock-on effects that has on families across the country. We know that 9 out of 10 cases of liver disease are associated with risk factors which with lifestyle change could be preventable. And I'll come back to our responsibility as legislators on that issue. We need not say any more than the fact that Scotland continues to have the highest mortality rate for liver disease in the UK, one of the highest across Europe altogether. This is not acceptable, and we can never allow that to be seen as such. To come back to my earlier point about avoidable deaths, I believe the root of much of this is health inequalities. Alcohol-related stays are 7 times higher in more deprived areas if someone is admitted to hospital, and alcohol-specific deaths, as we've heard, is 5.6 times higher. When a person born in one of the poorest communities in Scotland, they are considerably more likely to suffer serious liver damage over their shorter lifetime than anyone in a better-off community or than people in better-off communities. That is plain fact, and it cannot be avoided. If we are to address this problem, we need to, you know, be aware of this fact and add it into any of the remedies that we look or we seek to do. Doing so requires us to understand that alcohol is a toxic substance, and when drunk to excess, it can and does cause lasting damage, which has ongoing health problems for people and their families. We're not solely talking about people suffering from severe misuse. Here, you know, it does apply across the board to what is seen as sometimes casual or social drinking. I do often wonder if we saw the levels of alcohol-related problems in richer parts of our towns and cities as we do in the poorer ones, whether a national emergency would have already been called. But that seems to be the case. I'm sure people would agree with so many things that we talk about in terms of health inequalities. When excessive drinking and unhealthy eating is mixed with those who have an underlying genetic susceptibility to alcohol and obesity-related disease, you have a recipe for serious ill health that can blight some people for much, in fact, most of their adult life and can carry forward into other generations. And that's why, and I think we do accept this across the chamber, that a public health response is crucial to making sure we change these matters. We require serious efforts at all levels of government. We need to have really committed and serious discussions across the sectors. And I respect that some of this is a UK-wide consideration, but there are things that we have pinpointed that can happen here in Scotland to tackle accessibility, to tackle promotion of alcohol, and the way in which it is a key part of our advertising in areas such as sport and in the wider media. Many younger people are exposed to casual and dangerous drinking in that way. And if they've not seen it at home, it might be that is the way in which they're exposed to the normalisation of alcohol and alcohol drinking. And people may have been at a reception earlier in the session where young people, some of the young MSPs had done some work on this. And, you know, it's shocking to hear that people, I think it was as young as 8, can actually recognise cans of beers and lagers. I certainly would be unable to, but there's a whole range that children can recognise. And it just shows us how exposed they are to that time and time again. And actually, another important point is that public consultation and opinion polling indicates that the public do support some measures that we could put in through through a public health response to this. I'm conscious of time, Presiding Officer, so I won't go on any further, but I really appreciate hearing people's contributions and I look forward to hearing from the Minister. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Mochan. And I now call on Minister Marie Todd to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Apologies, rookie error. Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to thank my colleague Stuart McMillan for bringing this motion to the Chamber today. We all know how important it is to tackle liver cancer and liver disease, and despite liver cancer being relatively uncommon in the UK, sadly we know that survival is poor in most cases and that liver cancer has had the biggest increase in mortality rates compared to other cancers in the last decade. Liver disease has a bigger impact, affecting at least 2 million people in the UK and often related to harmful alcohol use, as we've heard, and an unhealthy diet, and we must continue to address those. To my colleagues today, thank you for sharing such valuable contributions to the debate. It's great to experience that united front across all parties in identifying the need to support the citizens of Scotland to prevent liver cancer and liver disease. I welcome the Love Your Liver Roadshow, an absolutely fantastic organisation. Their efforts to get around Scotland are to be commended, and I would absolutely recommend anyone with the opportunity to drop in and get a liver health check to do so. I'm grateful to Stuart McMillan for mentioning hepatitis C, which is a particular passion of mine. Scotland is world renowned for its leading approach in tackling hepatitis C, and we've committed to effectively eliminating hepatitis C virus by 2024-25, and we've made significant progress even during the last few years where we've been struggling with a global pandemic of another kind. The prevalence of chronic HCV infection amongst people who inject drugs has nearly halved, from 37% down to 19%. There was as much as a 60 to 70% reduction in parts of Scotland with the greatest scale-up of HCV treatment in this population group. And by 2021, 80% of individuals who were diagnosed with chronic HCV infection in Scotland had been initiated on HCV treatment. Now, that's phenomenal progress, and evidence indicated that the vast majority had cleared their infection from because of that therapy. So the Scottish Government will continue to work collaboratively with health boards and clinicians and public health experts, but isn't it phenomenal that in this day and age we have the opportunity to eliminate such a major cause of liver disease? I want to pay particular attention to the importance of preventing liver cancer and liver disease. This motion recognises the risk of both liver cancer and liver disease are increased by the impact of harmful use of alcohol and obesity, and we're determined to do all we can to reduce alcohol-related harm. It's still one of the most pressing public health challenges that we face in Scotland. We take a whole population approach to tackling harm in line with the World Health Organization's focus on affordability, availability and attractiveness of alcohol. And our alcohol framework in 2018 had 20 actions to tackle alcohol-related harm. And one of the key actions that has been mentioned in the Chamber today was the implementation of minimum unit pricing in May 2018. And since then, we have seen a 3% reduction in total alcohol sales, with a focus on those cheap, high-strength alcohols, which are often drunk by people who are drinking at harmful levels. And recent research by Public Public Health Scotland has found that MEP has been found to save more than 150 lives every year and 411 fewer hospital admissions. It's really encouraging, and Carol Mochan will be particularly interested in this, it's really encouraging to see that the research has highlighted that the policy is having an effect, the greatest effect in Scotland's most deprived areas, those areas which experience higher death rates and levels of harm from alcohol problems. And I think as we all consider what more we need to do, that's a really important point to remember, that this universal, untargeted measure has the biggest impact in the poorest areas because that's where the problem is greatest. We want everyone in Scotland to eat well and to have a healthy weight to help to reduce the impact of a range of diet-related ill health conditions, including liver disease. And we continue to implement the wide-ranging actions that were set out in our 2018 Diet and Healthy Weight Delivery Plan to address the challenge. And that includes our commitment to restrict less healthy food promotions and to improve the availability of healthier options when eating out, as was outlined in our out-of-home action plan. Where these preventative measures haven't had the anticipated outcome, we know that liver disease can increase the risk of liver cancer, and cancer remains a national priority for the Scottish Government and across NHS Scotland. We have developed an ambitious 10-year cancer strategy to launch imminently, and we conducted a public consultation on what its aims and principles should be, and there's a general agreement on priority areas, including placing an emphasis on the role of prevention and the less survivable cancers like liver cancer. The strategy will take a comprehensive approach to improving patient pathways from prevention and diagnosis through to treatment and post-treatment care, and its vision and aims will be supported by an initial 3-year action plan. Now, we know that the earlier that cancer is diagnosed, the easier it is to treat, and that's why the Scottish Government is committed to raising awareness of all forms of cancer, including liver cancer, through our Detect Cancer Early programme. Work to develop a new earlier cancer diagnosis vision in Scotland that will outline the future of this programme will form part of the new cancer strategy. And the programme helps to ensure that those with suspected symptoms of cancer are put in the right pathway at the right time. And our aim is to reduce later stage disease so that cancer, when detected, is much more likely to be curable. And that is all the more important when it comes to the less survivable cancers like liver cancer. So, Presiding Officer, in closing, I want to thank everyone who supports our NHS and our patients with a liver cancer diagnosis, including the role of the British Liver Trust in raising public awareness and taking that incredible roadshow around Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.